In the 1918 general election, Sinn Féin, led by veterans of the Rising, won a sweeping majority. But instead of going to Westminster, the party set up an Irish Republic. The Sinn Féin leader was Éamon de Valera, and his finance minister, Michael Collins. In an atmosphere made worse by renewed British threats of conscription, Collins would find himself directing a guerrilla war. The IRA campaign, which began in 1919, was met with fierce reprisals against civilians by security forces like the Black and Tans. A state-sanctioned policy of reprisal increased public support for the IRA. Killed fellow Irishmen, police shot IRA men, and vice versa. After 2 years of violence, both sides declared themselves ready to talk. In October 1921, a Sinn Féin delegation led by Michael Collins arrived in London to discuss a political settlement. Michael Collins arrived as the 20th century's first celebrity rebel in terms of his public image, a kind of Che Guevara for his age. But here, Collins would encounter a British negotiating team led by Lloyd George that was both experienced and tough. Whatever else might be conceded, an Irish Republic was not on offer. Twenty-six counties of Southern Ireland would become the Irish Free State, with its own army, but swearing an oath of allegiance to the British Crown. The government had already allowed the six Protestant-dominated counties of Ulster to form a new state within the United Kingdom. But it wasn't Ulster that caused crisis for the Irish side. In Dublin, De Valera accused Collins of having agreed to the oath of allegiance without his consent. When the Doyle convened in Dublin in December 1921, De Valera denounced the Oath of Allegiance as an abandonment of the Republic. Collins argued that the treaty gave Ireland the freedom to achieve freedom. The one-time comrades became bitter enemies. When the vote on the treaty came, it was perilously close. 64 votes for, 57 against. De Valera led his supporters out of the Doyle, and as they went, Michael Collins shouted, "Deserters all." The slide to civil war had begun. A majority of the people supported the treaty, but couldn't stop a war characterized by extreme ruthlessness. Both sides committed atrocities. At Ballyseedy Cross in County Kerry, 9 Republican prisoners were tied to a log and blown to pieces by a landmine, retaliation for the killing of Free State soldiers. The government army gradually captured the Republican strongholds. But on the 22nd of August 1922, Michael Collins was assassinated in County Cork.
Mick. Mick. Now, come on, talk, Mick. Yeah? No, Mick, don't go. Don't go, I mean. Mick! Come on, Mick. Oh, dang it, don't go on this, Mick, please. No!
The Free State would triumph, but his loss was devastating. In death, Collins would become a romantic icon, the great lost leader. Yet in some of his last writings, he espoused a patriotic pragmatism. True devotion, Collins wrote, lay not in melodramatic defiance or self-sacrifice, but in steady, earnest effort.
By the time the Civil War ended in 1923, Ireland was a very different country to the united and equal nation imagined by the revolutionaries of 1916. The revolution had driven the British out, but it had also consolidated the prevailing social reality. This was a Catholic, largely rural, and above all, conservative society.